Who are we talking about?
Elvis Costello.
Of course. He's come a long way since strumming a cardboard guitar in his parents' front room, and over the past four decades, he's thrilled fans by telling stories through his music.
Well, he's swapped the microphone for the moment for the pen to write his memoirs, all 674 pages of them.
We'll talk to him in just a moment. First, here's a reminder of some of his most famous work. I was always here to stay. I was always A few years ago, you wrote a song called Every Day I Write the Book. I didn't realise it was to be taken
literally. Yeah.
How long did it take you to write 674 pages?
About 3-4 years, when I really got down to it. I mean, when you start to write a book, you think of all the different ways you might do it. Like, I was born, and then do all the things in order. And then I thought, that isn't really going to be the way I'll tell
it. Because it's not like that. It's not like that kind. It's not that kind of autobiography,
is it? Because you can get that on the internet.
Yeah, you could.
Yeah, sort of made that kind of procession in order redundant. Well, if you just want the facts, if you want the emotion, then you have to read the book.
Did you find it an emotional experience writing it?
Some passages. When I read the audiobook as well. I mean, a couple of people have told me that they've read the book in a couple of days. It took me 8.5 days to read it in the audiobook recording.
Because it goes on for... It's 18 hours, I think.
18 hours, yeah. And obviously when you read it, you stumble sometimes and you have to retake. But, certain passages, when I wrote about my father's passing and some things in my life, when you had to say them out loud, it was a bit more emotional than when you'd written them on the page,
It's funny, you spoke about when you were, I think you were 17, when a friend of yours died in a car
Tony
accident.
Byrne, yeah.
And it was obviously in the book a very significant moment in your life, but it actually doesn't take up much in terms of words and pages. And I was quite interested how you address those emotional moments in your life.
Well, sometimes I would say that you probably weigh the words very carefully, because it's also other people's emotions. I mean, it's much more significant for his family.
Of course.
His, we were at school together. It was a really unfortunate accident. And it had the effect of making me wake up to the fact that, at 17 you think you're immortal, and then you realise that life can be taken away very suddenly, and you better get on with the thing that you love most. And up until that point, I've been diffident about pursuing music as an occupation. I hadn't yet come to the conclusion it was vocational, but you come to that later, So, yes, that's true. And I mean, when you're at that age, things are very deeply felt, and you may recognise the quality of this guiding principle of music and exactly how important it is likely to be.
You were born into music because your father was a musician and sang with the Joe Loss Orchestra.
And then around the working men's clubs around the north of England.
But you create this lovely picture of him taking you to the Hammersmith Palais.
Get me out of the house.
Get you out of the house on Saturday afternoon. Yeah. And you stood up there on the balcony and watched him. And I thought, I wonder if you must have got some kind of inspiration experience.
When you're seven, I don't think you think inspiration. It's just like, that's my dad up there.
Sort of subconsciously got you used to that kind of venue.
I think it definitely... It allowed me to see the transference from the mundane aspects of rehearsal to this magical thing where suddenly the light goes on and all the music starts. I remember that from very young, seeing groups play on radio broadcasts, groups that I liked out of the charts who would be guests on the show. That was pretty amazing.
Would it be fair to say that he lit up on stage?
He was a good showman. He was a better dancer than me, probably a better singer than me.
Well, shall we see? Let the audience decide.
Let them decide.
Here we go. I had a hammer, an hammer in the morning, a hammer in the evening,
so his moves outmove you. Okay.
Come on. You see why I've never been on Strictly?
There's still time.
There's always time.
There's still lots of time.
He had quite a varied musical life and was in the recording studios. Yeah. And one story I read, which I cannot believe you did, was you had all four autographs from the Beatles on one sheet of paper.
Well, he was on the Royal Variety Show, the Royal Command Performance of 63, because the Beatles, that was a big deal.
So, as a great dad, a kind, thoughtful dad, he got the autographs for you.
On a sheet of paper, but it was too big for my autograph book, so I cut round them. I know it horrifies people because I have all four autographs on one piece of paper, you know.
And then cut them out and stuck them in your book.
It was more that I just had them and he'd got them for me, you know. So, but, you know, I mean, I think... my parents met across the counter of a record shop, so records and things like autographs that are like souvenirs of a kind, I suppose, are more significant to me. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for love of music and knowledge of music between two people.
He was Ross McManus.
Yeah.
You were born Declan McManus.
Yeah.
You became Elvis Costello because your manager suggested that as an idea.
Well, it's a, you know, I mean, there's lots of people in show business. What about Richard?
I'm not
he's
saying
actually not that little.
No,
you know.
I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. In your family, are you still Declan or are you...
My mum calls me Declan, of course. Yeah. I don't really answer to people, strangers who walk up and call me Declan, because I think it should keep it. You know, it is, it's an alias for the stage.
Yeah.
It's a nom de plaque.
does it give you a different personality?
I've got several. Which one do you want to meet?
Who have you brought this morning, then?
The nice one.
There's a mean one, is there?
No.
The other thing I was surprised by was that you've said you released more records on the Dodgy Gramophone label than you did...
Coincidentally, I have, because records. When I started out, you know, those first things I said and those first records, always they make an impression and people will always measure you by the first, and it's great. It's great if your first records make an impression on people. But as time has gone on, I've recorded for lots of different labels.
What's meant more to you? If you look back at all the work that you've done, what means most to you?
Not one thing out of all. I mean, I've had some great. The next show, you know, could be the one where I play the best performance of any one song I've written. I've got lots of songs in play. I go into my songbook and I come out and try and tell a story every night made out of them. I'm not promoting a record.
Are you still excited about writing and performing?
I'm absolutely thrilled.
Does it still get the blood going?
Yeah, of course. But you wouldn't do it otherwise, yeah.
You've recorded with Burt Bacharach, Paul McCartney, Alan Toussaint. Is there anybody else you would like to make a record?
I never imagine any of those coming up, you know. Right now, I've been travelling across the United States, and just last night I was on stage at the Royal Court Theatre in Liverpool in conversation with Mark Billingham, the crime writer who was interviewing me the questions, a man who took me as a specialist subject on Mastermind, a man who might know more about me than me. Thursday night, I'm at the Festival Hall with Nick Hornby in conversation. I mean, these are people whose work I admire, and for them to take the time to, you know, read this book, which is, you know, it's not a reference book. It's a story. Yeah. Read it at your own speed. Or don't read it. It's up to you.
Elvis, it's been lovely having you with us. Thank you. And Elvis's book is called Unfaithful Music and Disappearing Ink.
Well, here's someone who's not going to disappear.